I remember someone saying that traveling leaves you speechless and then turns you into a storyteller. He was damn right. It's been a few months since our adventure started. We've met a lot of good friends, but also a lot of people who tried to get advantage of us. We've been treated as dear guests, but also left on the street by people who asked for a belt promotion, logo or exclusivity of their club in our documentary and didn't get it. But you cannot discover new oceans unless you have the courage to lose sight of the shore. And being scared is not in our to-do list these days, or ever. As they say, one's destination is never a place, but a new way of seeing things.
Hello guys, this is the Bjj No-Mad and we just landed in Abu Dhabi. This is the Abu Dhabi desert on the back and we're here in the new Bjj capital of the world. 500 black belts, maybe 600 as we speak, are located here and around here, and it's gonna be our next adventure to find the best places to train, eat, sleep, jiu-jitsu, camping, surfing, fun. We're gonna do some travels, Oman, Bahrain, Dubai, Alain in the middle of desert, and the list goes on. Stay with us for the next episodes of the... What's the name of this?
Bjj No-Mad!
Yes.
My name is Mihail, and for the past 12 years, I've been telling color people's life stories in the biggest reality shows in my country, Bulgaria. I'm a father, singer, animal rights activist, martial artist, and cinematographer in his journey to explore the spirit of everyday fighters around the world. My guide on this adventure is the original Bjj No-Mad himself, Dimitrios Tsitos, a lifeguard, ex-professional swimmer and Bjj black belt who spent last 10 years traveling around the world, teaching, competing and enjoying the lifestyle of a Bjj nomad, visiting more than 60 countries and never staying more than 6 months at one place. In the next year, our home will be the dojos of our friends around the world, in the ground under the stars. And don't believe them when they say nomad means you have no home. I say, nomad means you're home everywhere, you meet new friends. This is the Bjj No-Mad.
Boss. Again. you knew.
Of course, man.
Bjj No-Mad.
Living by the
living by the key.
Aloha.
Typical camel farm. We're gonna go down and talk with the locals now. This is the typical Arabia camel, the camel from Arabia. It has one, how it's called, peak on the back. Okay, many people have seen those with the two peaks. This is in the Sahara.
This was the everyday life in Abu Dhabi just 40 years ago. Sand, camels, and endless desert. 40 years ago, you had to drive your car directly on the sand. Of course, if you had a car, because the camel was the limo of the 70s in the region. But then, this man came on board, and everything changed.
At the wheel of this car is a man torn between two worlds. He's an Arab sheikh who was born in an old Arabia and will die in a new one. His forefathers ruled the desert from the back of a camel. He rides it in a limousine. He worships Allah, loves the desert, and is one of the richest men in the world. His name is Zayd.
Sheikh Zayed united the Emirates around and became the first president of the United Arab Emirates. 40 years later, even the goat shepherds here can afford a sports car, since after the modernization and the economic uprising of the UAE, every local takes a good salary monthly just because he is a local. And there are about 1.5 million Emiratis and another 7 million foreigners who work for them here. Not bad, huh? It seems to me that Zayed was a damn good politician, and I admire that because what we see on the Eastern European political scene is kind of different.
I investigation issues. Today we listen one, two, three voice from Iran opposition. MKO have a very, very difficult eyes.
Of course, I also like these guys. Sheikh Zayed made this country a great economical force, and his sixth son, Tahnun, made it even better when he fell in love with the first UFC event and decided to build the most respected grappling brand in the world so far, the Abu Dhabi Combat Club. Soon the Sheikh became the first Emirati black belt, but his brother, Mohammed, is the one who made the UAE a paradise for the jitsukas. He hired more than 300 black belts to teach in the country and made jiu-jitsu a part of the physical education in every single school here. This is an ordinary night train in Al Ain, a small city 1 hour from Abu Dhabi. 30-40 black belts casually rolling before the Abu Dhabi Open, where we'll compete tomorrow morning. This is a small part of the black belts here. They teach in the schools, government, private companies, and of course, jiu-jitsu clubs. Most of them are from Brazil and represent more than 100 teams out there.
My name is Marcos Túlio, I'm black belt from Della Riva.
Rio de Janeiro, game fight, upstream.
Zenit.
BJJ, check and match.
American top team US, I'm a pop lock in this bitch.
Rocinha, Brasil.
Denmark, Liga.
Kimura, Nauseal.
Castro Grace.
Us.
Hi, I'm Zaid from United Arab Emirates, from Al Ain BJJ Club.
Okay.
I'm down for, from Al Ain Club, from Club BJJ.
As you heard, the last two guys were locals, and because of that, they received free UAE branded geese and a lifetime training with guys like the best European black belt Alexander Trans, 4-degree black belt and a student of Hickson and Macharos Roberto Atawa, and of course, the most beautiful Greek nose ever, Dimitrios the Shark Tsitus. I'm here only for a few hours and already have the feeling that jiu-jitsu in the Emirates will certainly become a huge force worldwide very soon. With a few hundred elite teachers now, there will be a few hundred local black belts very soon, and you can do the math after that.
As you know, we have more than 180 coaches.
350.
Says more than 100.
350 is more than 100.
This is a big step for Emirates to improve very fast. Sheikh Mohammed bin Zayed, when he started the program, he says we have to start at what other countries finished. So the right thing to do is to bring the experience from out to our country. So that's what the Hanuses did. They brought all the black belts to improve our jiu-jitsu, to learn, to give the chance to our kids to learn and to improve very fast and to improve the system here in Emirates so fast.
This is Faisal Al-Kidbi, the only other Emirati except the Sheikh himself who earned his black belt in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu.
Faisal! Faisal!
He's a huge star here, and getting an interview with him is close to impossible. Fortunately for us, a lot of people in the martial arts scene around here are from the Balkans, so we somehow managed to do it. In Faisal's mind, choosing the BJJ for a national sport in the Emirates has far greater cause than just doing some sports. It changes mindsets.
His Highness started jiu-jitsu with their kids, with their sons, and he started to see changes in their attitude and their behavior. Then he asked to present this game to other sons, to other his sons, the United Arab Emirates kids. And UAEJJ noticed that from following the school programs, they noticed that jiu-jitsu are changing their mentally, they are working as a teamwork, they are making friends, and they are changing to better person.
عشت تجربة أشبه بالحلم. البداية كان لها طعم آخر. مع أول حركة في ساحة التدريب. أصبحت إنسانا آخر يعرف قيمة نفسه. أصبحت بطلا حقيقيا وثقتي بنفسي ليس لها حدود. نقلتني من محيط عائلتي الصغيرة إلى أسرة كبيرة. منها تعرفت على أخلاقيات ترتقي بالنفس إلى أعلى مراتب الاحترام. منها أستمد قوتي، وبها ترتفع معنوياتي إلى عنان السماء. جيجيتسو جعلتني في أعلى درجات التركيز والقدرة على الدفاع عن النفس. نعم، هي تجربة صقلت مهاراتي وعلمتني أنه لا شيء يسمى مستحيل. جيجيتسو لها مذاق آخر يمنحك القدرة على قراءة المستقبل والتوازن في الحياة.
A few days later, we were invited by the United Arab Emirates Jiu-Jitsu Federation to film the biggest school tournament around here. We are the first foreign crew to ever do that, so I'm really honored. But what touched me even more is what I saw there. This was one of the most intense and emotional kids' tournaments I have ever watched.
We're lucky that our people is changing to better and they have a new style of life, you know. This game, it's, you know, it gives you multiple choices, you know. It's not only you have to fight or you have to compete in competition. You can use it in other ways. So give it a try, give it a chance. And who knows, maybe we'll see you a champion. And we're still working for the Olympic. We want to have Jiu-Jitsu in the Olympic for the soon future. And this is, will be good for the game. It will be good for our kids to compete over there. And I think this is a big, very good target for the next 10 years, inshallah. Jiu-Jitsu, it's everything. It's everything. My biggest achievement is that I'm a good example to other people. This is life. You live to be good or you live to be a good for somebody else. Medals cannot make that, you know. Even if you are a good fighter or a good player, if you don't have a good attitude, if you don't have a good relationship with the people, medals will not make you a good, you know, a good example. Jiu-Jitsu changed me and make me a good person, and I'm lucky that I'm the way I am.
I have never ever imagined that Jiu-Jitsu can be such a big thing in a Muslim country. Just a few hundred kilometers from here is Saudi Arabia, where women are treated as an object and just an add-on to man's life. And here, these brave girls are fighting furious for medals without insulting their traditions. I have to admit that the life in the Emirates is a strange hybrid between the traditional Muslim values and the mindset of the modern Western life. Let me be clear. I'm a believer. I'm an Orthodox Christian and have God with us tattooed on me. Also, I'm from a country that was occupied and destroyed by the Ottomans for 500 years, so I'm kind of sensitive when it comes to Islam. But this place gives me nothing but a feeling of peace. This is the Sheikh Zayed's Mosque in Abu Dhabi. It's 15 minutes by car from the hall that the biggest Jiu-Jitsu events happen here. the Sheikh's body lies here. The guy wanted to build a mosque that unites, not separates, so he ordered materials from 16 countries as a symbol of it. Most of them are not Muslim countries. This is not a museum, it's a working mosque, and sometimes it gathers over 40,000 worshippers here. It's a beautiful place, and I really like how they defended spirituality. Few years ago, the security asked Rihanna to leave the place when they decided she is making an inappropriate photo shoot in front of the mosque. Well, I guess my selfie for the best jiu-jitsu magazine in the world, Jiu-Jitsu Style, was okay for them because they didn't say a word. So now, we are on our way to a place that I'm really looking for. The old fort in Alain. A little town in the middle of the desert, where tonight Dimitrios and some of my new black belt friends will make a final training before the Abu Dhabi Open tomorrow morning.
This is Al-Zahili Fort. It's close to downtown in Alain, and it is the old residence of Sheikh Zayed. Sheikh Zayed is the founder of UAE. He died 10 years ago, and now his son is running the Emirate of Abu Dhabi, and in general, he's running the whole country. Dubai is more the touristic center of the country. People don't know, think Dubai is the center, but no, Abu Dhabi has the wealth and the power.
And why was he living in Alain? Different?
Yeah, because back in the days, until 1960s or 1963, I think, there were different tribes that were fighting each other. And this tribe was located here in Alain. It's called Al Nahyan. It's the ruling family of Abu Dhabi. And then when Sheikh Zayed decided to unify the Emirates, all the families together, all the tribes, he moved from Alain to Abu Dhabi, because Abu Dhabi has a port, it's an island, it's close to the sea, so it's more easy for trade and more easy to communicate with the outside world. Here's in the middle of the desert. But still, Alain is supposed to be the most local place in UAE, the most, the highest percentage of locals compared with expat population. Do you have the feeling that this building is built like this to provide more space for the air to move around so it's more cold, Mihail?
I don't know, but it's for sure it's colder than outside.
Yeah, I think they, I don't know, it's my impression that they actually knew what they were doing, they were building. That's why they have these holes on the wall, and that's why they have the windows positioned like this. Even there at the, like the underpass, they have holes on the wall. So I think the air would circulate and cool the place, like a natural condition.
Few minutes from the fort is the animal market of Alain, which we decide to visit because it's on our way to the hall where we'll train tonight. This is one of the places here where you can buy yourself a falcon. The bird is the symbol of the Emirates and of course of its Jiu-Jitsu Federation. The locals don't hunt with falcons anymore, but every year they make this big event where their birds are chasing drones. And talking about chasing, this huge thing tried to kiss Dimitrios several times, and of course it's a male.
Just ask the guy here that is working here why this camel is by itself here in the center and looks different. And he said it's for reproduction, this camel. It's like alpha male and has to stay away from the female for obvious reasons. And it's super big, maybe, I don't know, 2.5-3 meters the top. If lift the head up, maybe 4 meters. Super big.
It's getting dark and we are on our way to the other side of Alain where the football stadium is. And football stadiums are the most common places to train jiu-jitsu in the Emirates. Somehow the both sports go in a package here.
Every football club in UAE, or almost every football club, has a jiu-jitsu, let's say, department. And there are coaches that are sent by the federation or by the company to teach jiu-jitsu to the locals or train amongst them. So this is the Alain chapter of Alain FC chapter.
So maybe the football fans that follow the football club also follow the jiu-jitsu club
for
competition.
Sure, and probably many of them come to train because they want to have advantage over other hooligans. You know, when they fight, maybe choke faster and go attack someone else.
Jiu-jitsu hooligans.
jiu-jitsu hooligans. Entering the hall, I'm very pleased to see that one of the biggest stars around here, the most famous European black belt Alexander Trans, is in the house tonight. The guy's destroying our crazy friend Carol. Trans is teaching in an elementary school and he seems to like it here.
In Denmark I was teaching jiu-jitsu and working as a bouncer as well and in the weekends. And then when I went to Brazil, a lot of times I would sleep in with some friends' houses and stuff like that, you know. And I lived with my parents back in Denmark. But then I met my wife and I got married, you know. And when you have, like, then you get another responsibility, you know. It's difficult. I can't just sleep on my friend's couch when I have a wife, you know. So that's something that's difficult about being European. Because if I was American or Brazilian, then I could teach in an academy and still have good training. But my problem in Denmark was, like, the guys are great there, like my friends from training. But like for me to compete at the highest level, it's difficult for me just to train in Denmark. So if I opened an academy in Denmark and trained, then I would not have the quality of training that I would need to achieve my goals. So I like it here. I have good training, a lot of good training partners.
Like 400 black belts.
Yeah.
I'm starting to understand why teaching in the Emirates is good not only for the students but also for the black belts. They have secured an everyday job with fixed payment and every evening have access to the biggest training camp in the world, a masterclass with another 350 black belts and champions from all over the world. It seems Trans found the right direction in his life, but it was not always like that.
When I was like in my teens, I was like, I had no clue what I wanted to do in my life. Like I didn't know, like, I want to be a police officer, I want to be a doctor, like I had no idea. And that created some frustrations, you know, and to not know, to not have a goal, you know. But when I started to dedicate myself and in jiu-jitsu and started doing well in competitions, then it just felt like natural, you know. And now I'm 100% sure that I'm gonna do this for the rest of my life. Like, I wanna keep competing and then one day I wanna open an academy, have my own students, you know, so.
Alexander is one of the guys that trains several hours every single day, so I assume that he'll win everything in tomorrow's competition. But I'm a little bit surprised to find out that he's not coming at all. Unlike many other champions I know, he's not hungry to get every single gold medal on his way.
Martial arts is a lot more than just the sport. The sport is an aspect of it, of the art. The important things that you take from it is not the medal from the competition. So of course it's a goal for me to dedicate myself to be a champion, but if I don't think that I will have failed if I dedicate myself as much as I can, I train as much as I can, and I don't achieve it in my career and I retire, then it's not like I will feel like the rest of my life, I didn't fulfill it, because I did my best, you know, and I enjoyed my training. But of course it's a goal, I think, for all competitors. Like, it's now I was third place two times and second place one time in World Championship, so of course that's a title that I would love to have that, you know. But it's not like I'm not putting pressure on myself. I'm just trying to train and enjoy, like, the way. Because it's not like I'm unhappy. Let's say I'm unhappy now and I'm only like suffering and only I'm not happy until I get my World Championship medal. But what is the guarantee that I'm gonna be a happy person if I get a medal? You know? So you have to enjoy the journey, you know.
It's almost 10 o'clock and maybe we should go to bed because tomorrow is a fight day. Nah, not us. Along with our good friend, ex-Bellator fighter and an American top team black belt, Sam the Big Chocolate McCoy, we decide to go to the hills outside of Alain, where we'll skate for a while. This is how we roll.
I think you guys got some balls, man, because I don't think, like, I would like to travel and go, like, to all the places you guys go to train, I'm too homesick, man. I want to go back home. I don't think I could do it. I can't go to the different countries. I'd be crying. I'd be curled up. Like, I remember seeing the episode you guys were on the boat. That'd be me, like, crying in the corner.
Don't be fooled by his words. This man is a true beast.
Fighting out of Coconut Creek, Florida, introducing Sam, Big Chocolate McCoy.
Sam will probably win it all tomorrow morning in Abu Dhabi. But not before a good midnight nomad skate session in the mountains.
We're gonna go to Jebel Hafit here. Usually I just use the GPS because I get really bad motion sickness. So by the time we get up halfway the mountain, I probably throw up.
Nice.
The way I roll.
Good you know? For telling us.
Well, I throw up in my mouth, you know, because nutrition is nutritious.
Even better.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we go later, man.
That's the thing, I'll save it. It keeps me full. So we start going.
Just like Alexander Trans, Sam is teaching jiu-jitsu in an elementary school here. Along with being a BJJ professor and an MMA fighter, he's also a writer and had published a book about traveling in jiu-jitsu. But before his sports career, he was a police officer. Yep, Big Chocolate, the BJJ cop.
I was a cop for 9 years and you know, it was good, man. It was a good job. I got to help people and sometimes it was tough, but for the most part it was a really good job. And then when I left the police department, I did a little bodyguarding and I started working primarily for Lil Wayne. And the guy is really cool. He's a cool guy. He's quiet. He's not what people think. You know, like, he skates a lot. He has his own skate park in Miami. And it's a good job, you know, and I work with a good group of guys. 1 week you could be a Lil Wayne, the next week you'd be working for Justin Bieber. But, you know, being a cop was. It's different.
Have you ever armbarred some criminal?
Yeah. Actually, yeah. The good thing about jiu-jitsu and being a cop was you could control people instead of, you know, you see a lot of videos of cops punching people and stuff like that, and I can't even comment on whether that's right or wrong because I'm not in their particular situation. I just found that jiu-jitsu helped me to be able to control people a lot better, because especially when you're fighting professionally, that's one thing that attorneys can use in court. Oh, well, this guy's a professional fighter. Why did you hurt my client? Or why did you do that? And you kind of, you know, you realize that with jiu-jitsu, you don't have to punch him, make him bleed, break an arm. You can control him until your other help comes, and then you can subdue the guy or lady, whoever. You know, in 9 years of being a cop, I've never used my taser once.
That's the parking lot, right?
Or yeah, this is one of the parking lots. We can go a little bit higher though, because there's one that's a bit more steeper, a little bit more steep.
Maybe
or we can go this
Mihail,
way.
I think maybe better here because we're talking with a white belt.
Yeah, we can go this way.
White belt and skating.
And skating? Oh man, then I'm like a yellow. But I'm gonna, like, you fake it till you make it, man. I do that when I was
fake like, it and you make it and you crash on the wall and you break it.
That's it. But then you can tell everybody you've been in a fight.
Let's skate.
Yeah.
You wanna see a nice crash on camera?
Of course, man.
Our friend Sam just received his third stripe, white belt third stripe in
Living by the Gi skateboard surfing.
That's the way I roll, man. BJJ Nomad for life. Son?
What? Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Hello, guys. We're here on our way to Abu Dhabi, the capital of UAE. It's not very hot as people would think, lots of desert as you can see. And Abu Dhabi is famous in fighting society for Abu Dhabi Combat Club. We're gonna go compete because, yeah, BJJ Nomad lifestyle is cool, but if you don't compete...
You fucked up a long time ago.
This guy never competes behind the camera.
True story.
Never competing,
never losing.
He competed once and he edited everything twice. He edited everything and it was like he competed for 20 different fights. Anyway, I'm going to compete in a local tournament. It's called Abu Dhabi Jiu-Jitsu Cup 2015. It's a local event, but with 500 black belts living here and so many locals practicing the sport, it's gonna be quite a tough competition. I'm gonna do the no-gi today, so let's see how it goes. And if I make weight, because I'm fat, we party a bit. So now I need to go run for 2 hours.
This is FGB Arena, the most important place for Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu in the Middle East. Every big event in the region is held here, and the locals are really serious about it. You can watch every single tournament on the television, even the kids' ones. The federation is investing in Jiu-Jitsu big time, and the sport is everywhere. Newspapers, magazines, billboards, malls. That's very nice, but if he wants to see his face in some other media than BJJ Nomad, Dimitrios has to find a way to cut 2 kilos for the next 70 minutes, unless he wants to be just a spectator. The Greek should really have left all the cake for me last night.
I'm ready to run now. I think this will be the best shot of the episode of the documentary, because it's simple. You cannot see my face. So, see you later, guys.
You look like a terrorist now.
Of course, the security came to check why the hell someone runs dressed like that. But it was okay. They recognized us from the kids' tournament 2 days ago. My friend lost the weight he needed, but it cost him a lot of energy. And it would be hard for him, because from what I saw there, the people were coming very dedicated, not only from the Persian Gulf, but also from the Muslim ex-Soviet republics and even China.
This is very important. Blue, go behind the camera, enter there, for the right side. Red, enter from the left side.
These guys were on a mission. The main rivals of the locals were the tough fighters from the ex-Soviet republics. Some of them told me that it was way cheaper to travel and compete here than anywhere in Europe. Many of the guys had strong sambo and wrestling background, which made the fight very entertaining collisions between the pure jiu-jitsu and the old-school forged strength of the ex-Russians. In some moment, the local reporters started acting like crazy, leaving their stuff and running to see something at the end of the hall. No one had noticed that a member of the royal families around here had competed incognito and won a medal. He was totally legit. I had watched one of his games against some Turkmenistan or Tajikistan guy. The shape was not shining with some crazy skills, but hey. Have you ever seen a politician in your country doing any other sport except speed stealing? Yeah, I thought so. Now it's time for Dimitrios' final fight. It was for the third place, and meanwhile Sam was resting, with his first silver medal waiting for the advanced open division final. BJJ Nomad crew was solid today. Dimitrios outplayed his opponent big time and won his bronze. Meanwhile, Sam was winning on points over a guy who already had 2 medals at the tournament today, doing huge heel hooks to everyone. Here we are, 2 medals for our crew at this event.
That's BJJ No-Mad.
But as Alexander Trans said, medals are not what makes you happy in BJJ. And what would really make me happy now is a visit to the place where everything we saw today began. The original hall that held the first ever ADCC challenge, and where a student of Hickson Gracie and Jean-Jacques Machado, Roberto Atala, is teaching nowadays. Let's go!
Straight from my heart for you, my friend. This song is for you.
This song is for you.
We are still in Abu Dhabi. And in a few minutes we'll meet a friend of mine who had a huge role in the growing of the jiu-jitsu in the Emirates. His name is Lubo, and he is also the co-founder of the first BJJ club in Bulgaria. My team, Real Pain. He has been living here for years, and his journey in the gentle arts started in the magical place we are going to, the original Abu Dhabi Combat Club venue.
Maybe it's him, I don't know.
He goes away.
Nowadays, Lubo is among the most respected people in the martial arts scene in the region. But 18 years ago, he was just another guy coming to this building to watch the curious new tournament called Abu Dhabi Combat Club.
In 98, this venue here was the home of the first ADCC tournament, which was quite interesting, an event, you know, that I had a chance to see.
Many big names took part in this event.
Only when they mean something to you, man. My first memories was that I didn't realize why these guys are lying on the floor and not punching each other. Because I was still young, I didn't know anything about jiu-jitsu. For a person who didn't understand the sport, it was not very interesting. I started a conversation with a boxing guy in the audience. We found the boxing more interesting in that time.
So you're involved with this organization since the scratch, since the beginning, right?
Since the very first beginning, yeah. So more precisely in 98 I was a spectator. A couple of months later I started training. And on the event in 99 I was already part of the referees team. I was involved in designing the tournament rules because they were still young, still developing. It took us probably 4 to 5 years to come up with the current rules that were fair for wrestlers, jiu-jitsu guys, sambo, judo.
Lubo was in charge when the jiu-jitsu program started here. Now he is responsible for the BJJ training in the military, and he is the head guy of the biggest mixed martial arts promotion in the Middle East, Abu Dhabi Warriors. The funny thing is that when he returned to Bulgaria, there were no coaches there, so he stayed blue belt for 10 years, which might be a world record for a 5 times a week fighter. Now he is black belt, and everyone in the sports world in the Emirates knows his name. Everything started here, 18 years ago.
As you see the venue right now, it used to be an indoor horse riding arena, you know, the one when they jump over hoops and stuff. And so back in 98, it was my first life experience of a tournament in general, because I was not an athlete. The most interesting part was a week to two before the event. Famous names would come here to train, to prepare. Jean-Jacques Machado, Hoyle Gracie, Hickson Gracie, Mark Kerr, Saulo Ribeiro, Leborio, all these huge, massive names, Zemario. These were guys that I met, and I obviously they took me as one of the referees and a nice skinny beginner. And many of them liked to warm up with me because I was of no threat of injury or releasing some of their secrets, because I obviously didn't understand the sport that well.
Through the years, Abu Dhabi Combat Club became the biggest and most respected grappling tournament in the world, having branches everywhere you can think of. I was blessed and honored to be the official videographer of the European Trials 2 years ago, and witness how this organization pushes the evolution of the grappling all over the globe. But its greatest victory is where we are at now, and Lubo is one of the guys that worked really hard to make it happen.
In 2000, I was promoted to the manager of this building. I was the manager of the Abu Dhabi Combat Club. When my job became promoting that sport, I can tell you that nobody knew what jiu-jitsu is. They couldn't pronounce it. And for that matter, not only jiu-jitsu, but other fighting sports too. You know, they've heard of WWE, but that was pretty much it. In that time, it was really difficult to convince people why they should train, why is martial arts good, why precisely jiu-jitsu, or why judo, why wrestling. And if you have to compare this with what jiu-jitsu has become today after the support of their highnesses and the leaders, it has progressed so much that now I'm surprised to enter a store, a grocery store, or a shopping mall, and the salespeople would recognize the broken ear, and they know it's jiu-jitsu.
So there is already an image built around this sport. It has become part of the national culture. We have thousands of kids training, thousands of soldiers training. We have events every month. You know, it took the Western world decades to develop it on such a level. And thanks to our leaders here and the support we receive, it's just become part of the daily life. You read about jiu-jitsu in the newspapers. 3 years ago, we had 200 kids competing on an event. Currently, we have to cut the numbers to 1,000 and have and leave many kids that cannot compete, although they desire to compete. So it has blossomed, it has progressed, and that's why I believe in the next 5 to 10 years, jiu-jitsu will be part of their culture.
Tomorrow we'll be back in Abu Dhabi to meet a friend of Dimitrios's, Roberto Attawa, a 4-degree black belt and head coach of Rio Grappling Club. But after a tough competition and a nice interview today, we're ready for some party and head to Dubai, the most popular place in the Emirates. Meanwhile, we receive a voice message from Attawa, who saw on Facebook that we gave one of our signature rash guards to Alexander Trans.
Better bring me the rash guard, if not, man, I'm gonna fucking kick your ass. Black Greek motherfucker.
It's damn hot outside, so most of the interesting stuff here is indoors. It's around 30 degrees Celsius, and someone recommends us to cool down a little bit and visit the ski slope inside the mall. Wait, what?
Minus 4 degrees.
Minus 4?
Minus 4.
And you were like, hey, I'm going with the shorts, no problem, man.
Because we're in a bit of a hurry, I ran in and I said, no problem, for a few minutes I'm gonna go with the shorts to check it out.
23,000 square meters indoor ski area inside the mall, in the middle of the desert. It's been working for 10 years now, and it's absolutely insane. It really feels like you're somewhere high in the European mountains.
BJJ Nomad, we're not in the Alps, we're not in Colorado. We are in
Alps or Colorado.
Pretty close, the guy still hasn't read geography. We're in Dubai. Pretty ridiculous what this guy's built here. It's pretty ridiculous what this guy's building here with this project also.
There is sink on the Balkans. This will happen when there is a snow in the desert. You use it for something that will never happen. I guess whoever came up with this idea have never been to Dubai. We make a test ride and we love it. Except the fact that they have real penguins captured to entertain the kids here.
Come on, man, real penguins?
I find this a real sign of a bad taste.
Imagine, folks, a penguin that stands 2 meters tall and can weigh over 150 kilograms.
Using animals for entertainment was always something we've been against, so we decide to leave immediately and go to a more animal-friendly place. This is Dubai's Autodrome, one of the three places in the world when you can drive a Formula One car by yourself. And our guide will not miss this chance.
You surrendered already.
No money?
He has the money.
He's got the money.
Arabs are crazy about any racing sports. Motorboats, cars, falcons, horses, you name it, they have it here. Actually, I bet that UAE is the place with the most sports cars per person in the world. And you cannot expect anything else from the region that supplies the whole world with oil. Dimitrios will try the formula for a few rounds and I hope he will survive, because we were joking the whole briefing where they explained how to drive this machine.
BJJ Nomad. New experience now.
I hope new, not last experience.
Driving the formula seems really fun, and I really regret that only one of us got the chance to try it, but we don't have a time for a second round, because tonight we decided to play casual tourist and booked a desert safari, something that will be by far every Formula 1 or snow slope in the world.
Last one to finish.
Yeah.
How was that?
It was interesting and loud. It took me maybe 2-3 laps to get adjusted. These cars are, I think, 200 horsepower, but still, you can, when you press the acceleration, you feel it, you know. I tried to overtake some guys, but then the officials here came and sat me down. Hey, what are you doing? No overtaking. So I had to relax, you know.
Black belt.
Black belt, man. Black belt in driving. No ego, nothing. Only dedication.
I don't have enough words to describe the desert safari we had. It was surreal. This Pakistani driver almost killed us at least 5 times trying to impress the Chinese couple on the backseat. But worse than death is when you're dying in the middle of the desert listening to disco mixed local music on a maximum volume for 30 minutes.
What?
Surreal.
So we entered the base camp with relief.
It was going crazy. Music. It's rhythm, man. Nani nani nana na. We should finish soon with this shot because I'm getting cold here.
I'm not sure what we expect to see here, but what we find out is that in the next 2 hours we'll have to hear more disco mixed local music along with Dervish dancers who are spinning themselves till we get sick. It's too late to realize this is not our place, because we cannot go back. The car will leave in 2 hours when the dancing show ends. Damn!
Vai! Aperta um pouquinho, papai, até ele bater, papai, pode apertar. Mas papai! Papai, papai!
This was shot when Grandmaster Helio was 95 years old. The voice behind the camera belongs to the UFC legend Royce Gracie. The guy who is constantly smiling while being choked is Roberto Atala. His nickname is Rizala, the laughing one, because he is always smiling no matter what. The smile is again on his face the whole morning while he is teaching local guys at the Abu Dhabi Combat Club original venue.
Slow on, don't fight like crazy. I live by the gi, I live for the gi, I live in my gi most of the time. When I was 19, I found jiu-jitsu. At that time, I didn't know how much big jiu-jitsu would be all over the world. So I had no idea how many opportunities I would have from jiu-jitsu. So I was heavily criticized by my family, by friends, to drop off the university and decide to follow jiu-jitsu, but it was a call. It was something like, I felt like doing that. I never regretted.
Racing before the race, but it's not easy.
Roberto is a very interesting guy. In one moment, he can tell you the spiciest dirty joke, and in the next something that you can think of for weeks. He speaks 5 languages, been world champion twice and European once, and trained under Jean-Jacques Machado and Hickson Gracie. But the reason we are here is because Dimitrios, wanted me to meet the man that inspired him to become a traveler and a BJJ nomad with just a few sentences, a decade ago.
Back in the days, I remember the conversation we had in Greece, and now you travel more than me, man. I'm proud that I could give you this advice and you don't regret that. But I don't want to give anybody advice because I'm a master in jiu-jitsu, but I don't believe in a master of life, really. Some guys want to tell you what to eat, what you should drink or not. It's your life. You must decide what you want. Do you want to get married early? Do you want to have kids? Is that your mission in life? You want to have a conservative job, 9 to 5? It's up to you, man. But if you follow your dream, if that's your dream to travel, to teach jiu-jitsu, or to teach other martial arts, do you believe that you can do it? You should go for it, because like whenever we choose a path in life, we cannot go back and change it again. Life has no replay. So if you have regrets, when you get to an older age, you're gonna be a grumpy person. And you must be happy about your achievements. So I think it's up to each individual to decide what they want to do. That's why I don't want to influence anybody. I didn't want to influence you. I told you my opinion, what I wanted for my own life. You know, it's the same in the competition also. In a competition, I don't want to tell my students, pass the guard, do this, do that, or I'm going to create robots. I want people to think on themselves. No, so a black belt approach for me, I don't consider myself a black belt, to be honest. I think I'm a white belt because I'm always learning. Every day I learn something new. And I came to this country to teach, but I also came to this country to learn. I think there's a lot of things to learn here, not only in the jiu-jitsu project, but everyday life in many aspects. And I'm glad I'm here for this moment. It's something that's gonna add something to my life. Let me go crazy with him, with this guy now.
Why crazy?
Because you imagine.
Yeah.
Let jiu-jitsu be everything, and let everything be jiu-jitsu. I think this is my philosophy for jiu-jitsu, you know? Jiu-jitsu, I think about jiu-jitsu. I don't think about it, but I'm doing jiu-jitsu even when I'm walking across the street. I don't believe jiu-jitsu is for everyone, okay? You can be handicapped and train jiu-jitsu. You can be blind. I have friends who are blind in jiu-jitsu, but there is one thing that you must have to be in jiu-jitsu: willpower. And some people, they give up. They don't have the willpower. Those people will never be black belts, you know? But you have the willpower, you come to the train, you are consistent, you are learning, you are progressing. Of course, maybe you don't compete, you're gonna take 15 years to get to the black belt, maybe 20. And the guy that competes and wins everything, maybe in 5 years. It's the same in the army. The army, if you go to war, you get promoted a lot faster than if you are in peace times. It's normal. So I have this analogy between army and jiu-jitsu very clear in my mind. I don't believe that jiu-jitsu would be only for the athletes. I think that everyone that has the willpower to come day after day to the gym, at some point they must be graded. The more you repeat, the better you get. You know, don't get the bullshit from Kit Dale. He doesn't know what he's talking about, you know. He's stinky as well. But anyway, doesn't matter. The fact is, the guy say you shouldn't drill because of this and that. Come on, it's proven already. You know, like the best guys, they drill a lot, they repeat, and that's how you learn, really. You know?
Yeah, Abdullah. Tap.
Not too bad for old man, huh?
Yeah.
I told earlier that I don't believe BJJ is for everyone, but I believe in BJJ without borders. You know, like I think BJJ is something to unite people. This is something that I strongly believe. So if I have a group that they are putting religion or politics inside the mat, that's not good at all. You know, like you have your beliefs, keep it to yourself. Doesn't matter you're Christian, you're Muslim, you're Jewish, atheist, Buddhist, It's all good as long as you respect the others. When you start preaching to others what they should do, religious or politically, man, this is not something I want inside my group at all. And that's very clear from the beginning. You know, like, we don't want to mix jiu-jitsu with politics, with religion. And that's the reason that this year in Poland, we had people from Ukraine and Russia. Those countries are at war. And those guys were perfect harmony inside the group and with Poles as well. It's not something easy, but we managed to do that because everyone in my group has to have this mentality. You know, like, you have to accept the differences. You have to accept the other people are different than you, and you have to understand that and respect that. You know, because jiu-jitsu is about respect. And if you don't respect other people's beliefs, what can you respect?
Say,
us,
us. Shukran. Good luck. See you guys tomorrow.
Us.
A Talon man, great speech. He should have been preparing for days for this interview to look smarter than us. Unfortunately for him, he may be smarter, but he doesn't have a free access to the only place on the planet where you can surf in the middle of the desert. Freaking awesome, man. This is Wadi Adventure, a water park very close to Alain, our base camp, which is just near Omanian border. Right in the middle of the desert, the locals have built the biggest surf pool in the world. As we said, jiu-jitsu is a real deal here. So when we called the water park, they have decided to cancel everything for the day. 4 square kilometers water park and a 30 people staff are only on our disposal. I'm not sure if it is because they really like us, or because in this country, you cannot film or take a picture of a woman in the water, no matter if she is fully dressed ninja style. On several beaches they have tasked me to leave with the camera. Anyway, it's goddamn hot and we have waves, surfs and a private water park in the middle of the desert. Again, this is how we roll.
Don't die in this episode, maybe in the next one.
As we progress on the documentary, you see I'm getting more stripes on my black belt in slavery. At the end, I'm gonna be professional slave. Because he has to shoot, so he cannot really help us here. No?
No, man, when you finish, I'll help you, of course, man.
You help me and you're gonna put yourself in the car, by yourself.
Man, I'm 84 kilos, it's a big help for you, big relief.
These are our last hours here in the United Arab Emirates. Tomorrow we'll travel to Oman, the closest country to our base camp. But before that, we have a lot of work to do. Along with our Polish friend Black Belt and absolutely insane guy Karol, we are going to camp tonight, relaxing, shooting some techniques on unusual places and meeting a man who nearly lost his life because of a jiu-jitsu rivalry. It seems it is going to be an intense night, isn't it?
So we're ready to go camping, east coast of UAE. UAE is not only sand and desert, there is nice landscapes with places you can freedom camping. and we're about to pack here with my friend Carol Migo, the Polish terror, or else known as the human corner, because wherever he touches you, he cuts you.
So that's Did you mention there are no toilets there, and we need this shovel if you want to take
a
shit.
No toilets.
You just dig a hole, make a poo, and cover this.
Carol, can you bring my fridge from upstairs if Bestie is finished?
Yes. Who is Bestie?
As you can see, we have everything necessary for a nomad trip, including jiu-jitsu mats, which we lose somewhere on the 6th minute of our adventure.
Did you see how did you ride? Your mat was like this.
How you know that?
Because I see now.
There is one mat on the floor.
Yeah, one.
Okay, no problem.
Like this. Look.
So we lost one mat.
Man, you cannot drive like this.
I will not drive like this.
What are we going
to do? We need to find the other mat. If it fell in the middle of the street, even if we find it, it's gonna be with the tires everywhere.
And maybe we go there and someone is already rolling, man.
Yeah. For giving massage in the middle
giving
of the street.
Massage, yes.
It has to be somewhere. It's there.
It's there, our mat. And the motherfucker goes specially into it.
Look at the mat.
Now we definitely look like a band of gypsies traveling around the world.
We find out the hard way that the mats are not meant for this ride, so we leave them and ride east. It's a promising beginning of our camping. We are heading to Sharjah, big city in the east where we'll sleep under the stars on the seashore. But first of all, we are about to film a technique right near the highway that goes through the desert.
BJJ Nomad!
We do a technique, so should I change clothes?
Fuck you! I told you 10 times, change clothes and let's put the canvas on the ground.
You didn't tell me if we put the canvas. Okay, where to put it? There, good.
No shoes on the mat, motherfucker. Thank you. And if you want to go in, bow. It's traditional torture.
Because I am paranoid by nature, I'm a little worried how it looks to have two muscled half-naked men with sunglasses, a Thai girl and a camera in the middle of the desert. I really do not want to stay in prison for sodomy, especially in a Muslim country.
This looks like porn now, really. This looks like porn.
Oh,
I think we're gonna go to jail, even worse. We need to shoot a technique, but we don't have someone to help us.
Hello, good people. What are you doing here?
Well, we're just about to shoot a technique. Will you help us?
Of course.
You're right, Bill.
Yes.
Man, that's amazing coincidence.
I live by the key. I always when I...
You live by the key,
yeah.
Same for us.
By the key, no the key.
No, not the key. Not the key. So I'm within my opponent's close guard. What I need to be careful here is keep my hips as low as possible and my knees a bit more open, so I have better base. The next thing, I start low my technique. I tried simple other passes and it didn't work. So now what I will do? I'm gonna use my left hand, thumb pointing at me. I'm gonna put my four fingers on his lapel. And more or less on the clavicle level. Okay, not too low, not too high. So once I grab the lapel, okay, the next thing I'm gonna do, my other hand also pointing towards me, but I'm flexible with that. I can grab also here or here. What I will do, I'm gonna shoot my hand, my left hand across to the other side on the shoulder. It's like choking him, but at the same time, I'm gonna start standing up. So I have my base low, get low. Shoot my hand across, step, step. Now I apply pressure on his neck and on his windpipe with my left hand. My right hand is pulling the lapel towards me. And very important, my left foot is gonna push his hips to the other side. There. So once he opens, I just remove everything and walk back. That's the most simple and most effective way to open the close guard. So one more time. Knees wide open. Hips as low as I can, as low as my flexibility allows, and I control. Obviously, I'm not with my elbows open because he can move his hips left and right. I close my elbows, head down. I reach out, maybe I need to sneak and look. Grab his lapel, pull it. Grab the other lapel, keep it close to me. Once I'm ready, left hand is gonna shoot the other side with the lapel, and I'm gonna apply pressure on his neck. And I'm gonna start standing up. One, two. The most important detail on this technique is how I position my knee, my left knee. So I have my left hand pushing his lapel across and kind of applies the pressure for the choke. My left knee should be pushing his hips inwards, like this. Because if I just stay with my base parallel, he goes for the arm lock and I tap, or he goes for the shoulder lock and I get caught. So I need to kill, very important, I need to kill his hip mobility, his hip movement. How is this done? Left foot pushing the same direction my hand is pushing. He opens, I move back. Okay, he does that, I'm fucked because I don't know how to pass this guard. Was. Beleza.
Straight out of Poland, Nowa Huta, Krakow. As real as it gets.
On our way to Sharjah, we shot several techniques that you will be able to watch throughout the year in our short video series called The Fifth Stripe. But Jiu-Jitsu is a lot more than just a martial art. It's a life path. And sometimes, it can get you to some very dangerous places. Let me tell you the story of a man who almost lost his life because of his dedication to BJJ. Meet Jeff.
People like to say, you know, Jiu-Jitsu saved my life. You know, in my case, opening a school of Jiu-Jitsu almost took my life. You know, I almost died for this. I paid the ultimate price, you know, and good thing I'm still alive, so I mean, I'm here to tell the story. This was 10 years ago, 2005 of September. I was affiliating with one guy from a gym, and basically I opened my gym up, and on the 30th day of it being open, apparently another group of, you know, BJJ guys, I guess they were planning for a while to, you know, get rid of me because they had an idea that I wanted to open a gym, and in this particular place there's a lot of politics with jiu-jitsu. So I opened my gym, you know, I was thinking, okay, you know, the most these guys would ever probably do is like, hey man, you know, we don't want you teaching, you know, maybe pick a fight with me. But this day in September, I was coming out of my gym, just got done training, I was still covered in sweat, you know, going to my car, and then a van just pulled up, blocked my car, and about 10 to 15 guys came out of the car. I was just like, oh shit, I know exactly what this is. It's like, this is a hit. You know, I was like, fuck, you know. Some of them had firearms, most of them had knives and bats and stuff, and pretty much it was an assassination. It was a hit to take me out, so. I got stabbed 12 times, and these guys were hitting me with bats and all this stuff, and it was weird. It was like a CQB thing. We actually got in the car and we were fighting inside my car, and there was like three guys fighting me with knives, and I was actually, it was weird. It was something like in the Matrix where it was slow motion. I was just paying attention to the blades. So I didn't really look at their faces. It was nighttime, so I wasn't concentrating. Okay, I need to see what this guy looks like. It wasn't that. I was concentrating of surviving. So I think maybe jiu-jitsu somewhere there helped me, maybe. I mean, I still got stabbed several times. You know, I almost died. I had a punctured lung, collapsed lung. I got hit in the liver. They tried to hit me in the femoral artery, which they missed. You know, I would have been gone for sure if they hit me there. But yeah, I'm here right now. I'm very lucky. I believe that, you know, it just wasn't my time to go. I mean, I really thought I was gonna die. I was in the car. These, you know, two guys helped me out. They brought me to the emergency room, and I really thought it was, you know, my time. I was in the car laying down, just bleeding there, and I was telling them, you know what, close my wound here, I'm bleeding here. I could feel the air coming out of my lungs, you know, from the hole in my back. And I was like, shit man, this is it, I'm gonna die. And I was really scared, and it was just something that I wouldn't want anyone else to go through, because it's a very horrible feeling. And after that, you really realize how valuable life is and how short life is, and how easy it is to just, one day you're just gone, and then you're like, man, I didn't get to do all those things I wanted to do. I'm gonna die, man, you know? For about 2 years, I mean, after this happened, I had really bad PTSD. You know, I was on a lot of different medications, and I was, you know, I separated myself from all my family. I didn't want to talk to anybody. I didn't want anything to do with jiu-jitsu. And I was really mad. I was really angry about everything that happened because I didn't understand it. And in this particular country where it did happen, it seemed like, you know, there was no justice because these guys are still out there, you know. After those 2 years, you know, I felt that maybe, you know, all the medication I was on, I was like, man, I don't think this is helping me. I don't think it's helping at all. So what I did is I pretty much just got rid of the medicine cold turkey. You know, I just tried to deal with this issue on my own. And I think it was better without the drugs. I don't think we need the drugs. I think they don't really help you. You know, I think that our mind is stronger than anything else. Well, after about 2 years, you know, I started, you know, seeing some friends. They were still training. They're like, hey, man, you need to come back to jiu-jitsu. And I didn't reply to them. I didn't really want to have anything to do with it anymore. And one day, you know, it's just one of those things. I was like, I got off the medication. And I was like, hey, I want to get back into jiu-jitsu. I want to rehabilitate myself naturally without any drugs, without anything. And I came back slowly, you know, come to the, you know, training once in a while. And pretty much I rehabilitated myself. I've been off medicine for about 8 years now. I don't take any antidepressants or any of these downers that the doctors put me on. I got into firearms training extensively. I trained a lot with pistol, with rifle. And for a couple years, that's all I was doing. When I wasn't training jiu-jitsu, I was just training extensively with pistol, with all different situations. Training with, you know, some special forces guys, showing me different ideas. You know, I went to all different schools to have, you know, different ideas of what kind of training I could get. And after a couple years of this, I eventually got, you know, a phone call from a friend. He's like, hey, man, you want to work with the UFC? Working executive protection. I was like, hey, that's, you know, pretty cool. I would like to do it. So that's when I got my first taste of working in the executive protection field. The first big job we ever did was working with the chairman of UFC. We worked with Lorenzo Fertitta. They put me with Chuck Liddell, which was pretty cool. I was like, oh, I get to work with, you know, one of the big names in UFC. And it was a really good experience. After that, I mean, this whole incident that happened with me, I felt like I had some type of, something was compelling me to, like, even want to protect people, you know, and to prevent anything like that from happening to them, what happened to me.
Jeff worked for the UFC for 3.5 years and then got into the re-election as a member of crisis response team for a big company in the United States. Meanwhile, he managed to get his black belt in jiu-jitsu. Now, he is really a well-rounded warrior, so I ask him if he regrets he didn't start with a different martial art before jiu-jitsu, so he could avoid the accident that happened to him a decade ago.
One thing I can guarantee you, no matter who you are and no matter how much skill you have in any martial arts, if you're fighting a group of guys that are trained with the knife, I guarantee you're gonna get cut, and you'll be lucky to leave that situation alive. Because most people that are in a knife fight, all right, they end up dead. And that's a statistic, that's very true. So you see guys out there saying that, oh man, I can disarm this guy with a knife or with the gun or whatever, but yeah, I wanna see you do it for real, you know? Do it in front of a camera with a compliant adversary, yeah, for sure you could do it. Do it against a guy that's really trying to kill you. I guarantee you're gonna get cut. If I could have run that day, I would have run. You know, I would have gotten out of there right away if I had the chance, but it just wasn't, that day it didn't happen. I had to pretty much defend myself at all costs, and I was luckily I came out of it alive. Life is just so short. You know, after that, I tried to stay as humble as possible, you know? I mean, the ego is that thing that just eats inside of you, but if you just try to control that and, you know what, put that aside, it doesn't matter. You know, just try to live your life in the best way possible, being, you know, good to your fellow man. You know, there's no need for us to kill each other. You know, it's bullshit, you know.
In the meantime, keep a rifle in your car, just in case.
It's funny you say that, I used to do that. I had a lot of firearms with me after that situation, a lot.
This is the real life. No Facebook quotes, no jiu-jitsu saved my life, not even living by the gi. We've met a man who almost lost his life because of jiu-jitsu, and then regained it because of it. We've met a great champion who doesn't believe that a piece of metal has something to do with the joy of the art we have chosen. A great master who prefers to raise happy people rather than robot champions in his gym. And a country that have adopted the martial art we believe in as a part of its culture. Yes, we're all living by the gi, but not because we wear it on the mats, but because we try to live by the code that comes with it every single minute. We're also nomads, but not because we travel, but because we seek. We are dancing on the graves of our comfort zones and search for something more in this life. We live by the gi, we'll die by the gi, and try to be as happy as we can in between.
Jiu-jitsu is my way of life.
هذا أسلوبي.
جيتسو حياتي.
أسلوب حياتي.
منحتني السكينة والشعور بالسلام الداخلي والراحة والانسجام مع كل شيء.
خليفة مراد مشاهدينا الكرام قاعد يعطي الميدالية الذهبية إلى سيدي الفريق أول سمو الشيخ محمد بن زايد آل نهيان.
غير قواعد اللعبة بانضمامك لجيجيتسو. جيجيتسو غيرت حياتي، غير حياتك.
Soldiers, take position. For the last will be first. And the first will be last. You see, many are called, but few are chosen. You were called for a reason, to go forth to the nations and spread the good news and proclaim the power of his blood. God sent me for a reason, to watch, fight, and pray in and out of seasons. God sent me for a reason, no plan B, I'm done when I stop breathing. God sent me for a reason, to watch, fight, and pray in and out of seasons. God sent me for a reason. No plan B, I'm done when I stop breathing. God sent me for a reason. I'm on borrowed time, so any minute I'll be leaving. But since I'm still breathing, best believe I'm scheming to be casting out demons. We fight for freedom, coming against the devil, turning saints back to heathens. And my heart's still beating to have a burden for the hurting. That's the right reason. Houston, Houston, we have a problem. Babies being murdered, mom and dad don't want them. All I hear is everyone talking about the economy, but what about 25 million watching pornography? Huh? And that's just in America. Your reputation's clean, but you got a dirty character. I'ma be the change and chase after the lost. I'ma stand up and lead us back to the cross. God sent me for a reason, to watch, fight, and pray in and out of seasons. God sent me for a reason, no plan B, I'm done when I stop breathing. God sent me for a reason, to watch, fight, and pray in and out of seasons. God sent me for a reason, no plan B.
You know why I always swim with the belt? Because you are black belt, not only on the mat, also in the water.
Oh. Open up your heart and he'll restore your purity. He is never shaken, but he can shake a nation. When demons hear his name, he can wait like a vacation. Walking with authority, flowing like a fountain. I put my trust in him, cause he can move the mountain.